Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Jodi Taylor, and I am a shareholder in Baker Donelson's Atlanta office. My practice is comprised about 50-50 of employment law and construction law, and our topic this morning, OSHA, really hits at the sweet spot of both of those. So I'm very excited that we'll be talking about the top 10 things that HR professionals need to know about OSHA. A few housekeeping notes before we get started. You'll notice there's a Q&A box on your screen, and if there's not, please shoot an email to the notification office and where you received the email for this webinar, and we'll make sure to get you set up. But if you see that Q&A box, please feel free to submit your questions in the box. My plan is to get through all this material because we do have a lot of information, and I want to make sure that we cover everything, and I hope to leave time for questions and at the end. And certainly if we run out of time, I'm happy to go offline and discuss those after the presentation ends. But please feel free to insert questions, but I wanted to let you know you are not being ignored. I plan to wait to the end, and then we will address as many of those as we can. Also, there is a blue survey box that you will see at the end of the webinar. We encourage you to please insert your comments, give us some feedback. We'd like to know how we can make this better for you. We want to provide the best information that we can. And also, this gives us an opportunity to find out additional content that would be helpful for you in your business. A PDF of the presentation will be available in the resource list, and it will be emailed out to you in the next couple of days. And also, please connect with us. Baker Donelson social media links are at the bottom of your screen. So if you are active on Twitter or LinkedIn, please feel free to join us there. So with that taken care of, let's move forward. And here's a roadmap of where we're going today. Part one is going to be a brief overview and background of OSHA, the kind of tripartite of record keeping, reporting, and inspection, with more of an emphasis on inspection. Because I've looked through the list of the folks joining us today, and we've certainly got a good mix of folks, and the majority are folks who are in the HR department, which is great. That's who this is too. So we want to make sure that you get the background that you need on OSHA so that the top 10 list, when we get to that, will make sense to you. And then part two will lead into that top 10 list for HR professionals. For you folks out there who are in the safety departments, I've seen a few. Hopefully this will be a refresher, and there may be some things that are either new to you or will help. But what I hope you can gather from this also is how you can utilize your HR department to assist you with your safety needs. So let's begin with part one, which I'm calling OSHA 101. And to get started, I'd like to take a question or pose a question to you and find out how well do you know OSHA? You may be very familiar. If you're in safety, or maybe if you're in a smaller company and you are safety, your local commissioner's number may be saved in your favorites on your phone. If you deal with OSHA on occasion, you're familiar, but you have a safety department that leads the charge, that may be your camp. And then OSHA, they inspect after an accident. I think that I'm glad that you're here if that's where you fall. But if you could respond to this poll question, let me know how well you know OSHA and your familiarity there. That'll help guide where we go with the presentation today. So I'll give you a couple more seconds to respond, and then all right, now let's see. Okay, so this is good. We've got a few people that are very involved, which I'm guessing those are my safety folks. 90% of the people on this presentation today deal with OSHA on occasion, but you have a safety department. So that's great. I think this is going to be really helpful for you to get some information to take back to your safety department, and you guys can learn how to work together. And then OSHA, they inspect after an accident. Okay, good. Glad that you guys are joining us. I think this will be really helpful for you to take some information back to your company. So OSHA stands for, we always use the acronym, but it is the Occupational Safety and Health Act. And that act governs the Occupational Safety and Health Agency, which is usually when we say OSHA, we're referring to the agency. We're not always referring to the act. And I've quoted Section 5 here. I've drawn from Section 5. And that is really the crux of what OSHA is promulgated to do. OSHA is here to make sure that employees' employment and their place of employment are free from recognized hazards that are causing or likely to cause death or serious physical harm to employees. And secondary to that is that the Act is out there to require employers to comply with the regulations in place for specific industries or general. So that's the crux of what OSHA does. That's kind of the crux of what we're here to talk about. And, you know, I think everybody can agree on that global level, we want a safe work environment for our employees. You know, we don't want certainly to have, of course, you know, fatalities or serious injuries. So, I mean, everyone's on the same page from that standpoint. But where, you know, it can get a bit tricky is sometimes there are citations that aren't really getting at, you know, true workplace safety. Sometimes some jobs are inherently dangerous, and there may be accidents and injuries, and it's no one's fault. Sometimes it is someone's fault, and it's the employee's fault, and we've trained that employee, and it's not the employer's fault. So, you know, big picture, everybody wants to keep the employee safe, but we need, you know, from that standpoint, we all want to be friends, but we also have to be guarded and careful to make sure that we don't have an overly aggressive commissioner or deputy who's you know, somewhat on a witch hunt to kind of get something from an employer. So with that being said, too, this might be more for the 6% that are less familiar with OSHA, but maybe even for our majority, 90% of folks that are familiar but have a safety department that may handle more of it. OSHA really has three separate components. There is a record-keeping component, there is a reporting component, and there's an inspection component. The recording component is recording recordable injuries and illnesses, keeping a summary of that, and then reporting that. And you may have heard some of these terms. The OSHA 300 log, that's where it's just a log where you're recording injuries and illnesses. They need to be recorded within 7 days of the event. There's the 300A, which is a summary of that log. And then there's the 301, which is a report that's submitted with the injuries and illnesses that have been compiled in your logs and summary. What is recordable? It's a work-related new case, specific injury. And, of course, there's, you know, some specific language that can provide guidance on what really could be work-related. I mean, I think a cautious rule of thumb is if it happens at the workplace, at least pick up a phone and call somebody. If you have safety, call safety. If you don't have a safety department, you know, call your attorney to decide if this is recordable. Who is covered? Again, I've looked through here. I think it's safe to assume everyone that's joined us today is covered, but pretty much all private employers are covered, and state and local governments are covered if there is a state plan in place, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. There are some exclusions from OSHA, and the safest assumption is to assume you are governed. The exclusions have to deal with small farms, commercial diving, some industries that involve hunting, fishing, gaming, and even within those exclusions, it's not a full exemption. In some instances, there may be you may be exempt from certain inspections, but not a post-accident inspection. And generally, all business, private businesses are required to report. So there may be exemption from record keeping, but you still need to report an accident. So rule of thumb is assume that you are governed by OSHA. If you are not, then I reach out to your safety department. If you have a safety department, I would assume you're probably not exempt. But reach out to an employee or an attorney just to confirm. And I mentioned a moment ago, in some instances, there are state plans. OSHA is a federal statute, and the federal OSHA agency has oversight over its enforcement. However, states are given the ability to opt out of federal enforcement so long as the state plan is at least as effective as the federal plan. More than half the states operate under their own plan, and federal OSHA has to approve each of the plans. So this is considered another exemption from federal OSHA, but it has to be approved. It has to be at least as effective as the federal plan. And here's a list of the current plans, state plans that are in effect, if you'd like to look and see where your state falls. And note that Connecticut, Illinois, New Jersey, New York, and the Virgin Islands, those state plans only cover the public sector, which is, I mentioned earlier, state and local government typically would be exempted out from OSHA's reach unless there is a state plan in place that covers. So in those states, the state plan would cover the local government employees only. Some just general information, OSHA by the numbers. It's a relatively small federal agency. There's one compliance officer for every 59,000 workers. In fiscal year 16, there were just under 32,000 total inspections by the federal OSHA. There were just over 43,000 total inspections for the state. And if you think about how many employers are out there, there's not a ton. OSHA is not an incredibly active agency, like a DOL, although I'm sure some folks on here, especially in the construction industry, might beg to differ. But, from an federal agency standpoint, they're not extremely active. Their budget's been flat the last 2 years. There's some modest increase in the requested fiscal year 2017 budget, but likely it will be roughly the same. So, they have their manpower is limited, and they don't have a huge budget, so that kind of does lead to less aggressive activity. And there are 10 regional offices with 85 local area offices. So no matter where you are, there is OSHA nearby for sure. Our last slide just on some general background, and I thought this would be helpful for folks who aren't as familiar with OSHA. Here's what came down as the top 10 most frequently cited OSHA standards for its previous fiscal year. OSHA's fiscal year runs from October to September. So the fiscal year we just completed, this is what was the top 10. Number one was fall protection in construction, and that makes sense. It's open and obvious. They don't even have to be on site. They can drive by and see if someone's tied off or not. So that's kind of the easy low-hanging fruit. Which, from the construction folks on here, I'm sure know that's why you have regular safety meetings, why you're constantly training, because that's just too easy. Hazard communication standard. This is in a general industry. So, again, this is going to apply to everyone. And the hazard communication standard has to do with the training and information on handling and using hazardous materials. This could apply certainly in medical fields, in motor carriers with transporting hazardous materials. So this, if that's your industry, this is another one of the hot topics that seems to come down. Scaffolding, again, this is construction. Again, it's low-hanging fruit. It's pretty open and obvious. Respiratory protection, that's, you know, ensuring that the workplace is not contaminated with harmful dust, fogs, or fumes. We want to make sure that the work environment that employees work in is safe, and that's, again, general industry. It's been one that's been a hot topic recently. Lockout, tagout, this is making sure that heavy equipment is restored to its resting place, turned off, or if you're changing shifts, that the employees change out safely. That's been another hot topic. Powered industrial trucks, forklifts, that's the most obvious one on this list, but they're smaller motor vehicles that are typically going to drive around a warehouse, around a loading dock. It can be a little open and obvious as well. I mean, if someone's driving around outside on a dock, it can easily be seen. And I point out about this open and obvious just, again, to kind of get you thinking about what you can do to, you know, where you see the risk, the greatest risk for your company, and, you know, maybe where you think some additional training could be helpful. And anytime it's outside, that's open and obvious and can increase risk. Ladders. For construction, electrical wiring methods. There's two in the electrical component, and we'll hit the second one in just a moment. But this has to do with large equipment, how it's wired, making sure that the electrical equipment is maintained safely. Machinery and machine guarding. This is making sure that the welding materials or any type of machinery that might be used in manufacturing is safe to the individual who is utilizing it and also those around, that sparks are not flying off. In electrical systems design, this is general electrical equipment and just, again, safe workplace. So this has kind of been the hot topics for the last couple of years and what's been primarily cited. So let's talk about the inspection, and I think that's a place where unless you don't have a safety department, which it appears that most folks do, so the record keeping and maybe the reporting is probably going to be handled more by safety. If not, when we get to our top 10 list, we'll talk about some of that as well. But I felt like for this audience, it would be helpful to go through the mechanics of an inspection because the HR really can almost be first line of defense in helping to prepare and prevent an inspection, frankly, but also prevent it from going awry. So what causes an inspection to occur? There's a couple different mechanisms are ways that OSHA can get in to inspect. One is a strategic targeting inspection. We mentioned earlier the reporting requirements, and from those, you know, the OSHA 301, when those are compiled, OSHA, your local area OSHA, may look and see, ooh, you know, this builder has had an awful lot of ladder falls. I think we're going to do a strategic targeting inspection and figure out what's going on. Maybe there's not enough training. You know, why do all these ladder accidents keep happening? Complaints. Well, we'll talk about this. This gets its own slide. And I also think it's very important for the HR folks on here. But employee complaints can cause an inspection to occur. A national emphasis program. This is from a higher level. If, in general, there's an industry that's inherently hazardous, we see a lot of accidents occurring from, for instance, in my region, in Atlanta, there's currently a national emphasis program on power industrial vehicles. So there's seen to be a lot of accidents from forklifts and wondering if maybe we need to revise some training, if the vehicles are being properly maintained. So there's a national emphasis program that allows OSHA to go on to properties and businesses that utilize these trucks and conduct inspections. Referral, if there's a media expose on some type of safety hazard. Other agencies, or again, the Plainview, sorry, construction, that one gets you. Fatality and multiple hospitalizations, an accident is the quickest way to get OSHA out. I've never known there to be an accident and not be a follow-up OSHA. It doesn't always mean there's a citation, but, it's like matter of course. And this is another thing, if you don't have a safety department, but also I think checks and balances are always great. So I wouldn't think that this is mutually exclusive, that it has to be for safety. But these reporting, because there's such a quick turnaround time, I think it helps to have HR involved in this as well. Work-related fatalities must be reported within 8 hours of the fatality, and don't alter the accident site because OSHA needs to inspect it. It's a quick turnaround. They'll be out there. So you don't have to leave it out for a long time. If there's a hazardous reason why it needs to be moved, of course, there's always some extenuating circumstances. But if possible, leave the accident in its original form until OSHA inspects. And then if there's a severe injury, which includes inpatient hospitalization, amputation, or loss of an eye, that needs to be reported within 24 hours. So I threw that in there because I think those are important enough. I want to make sure that we get them out. But those reporting those accidents will likely lead to an inspection and follow-up inspection. If there's been a previous citation or incident, and typically following a citation, if the inspector wants to come out and ensure that whatever hazard has been abated, which is the terminology, abatement is essentially stop or cease to make sure that the hazard's been corrected, that will lead to a follow-up inspection. So I promise complaint-based inspections guide is inside, and here it is. More than 20% of all OSHA inspections are complaint-based. So that's a pretty hefty majority, considering the other possible ways that an inspection can occur. OSHA allows complaints to be filed online. They also allow for anonymous complaints, and the complaint can be maintained anonymous even following an inspection. So it's pretty easy for an employee to make a complaint. And the Government Accountability Office has released some data that indicated OSHA inspection rates at establishments that experienced labor unrest is 6.5 times higher that at establishments that did not experience such unrest. So this is where I think HR can be critically helpful and important with OSHA, in that part of your job already is to help maintain a healthy, happy, productive workforce. And if that component can include reducing any type of employee complaints, including OSHA, I think that's where the HR department can complement and assist safety, if you have a safety department, to keep folks happy. And this also dovetails with areas that have a larger component of union workforce see a lot more of these complaints also, because oftentimes the union will work almost in concert with the OSHA deputies or commissioners to kind of make these complaints, work on abatement. So yet another reason to, if you do have a union workforce, keep complaints to a minimum, work with them so that you don't bring in another force that effectively is working against you. So to that end, for handling some of these employee complaints when they come up, it's helpful to review procedures for employees to raise safety and health concerns. And importantly, are your procedures confidential? Are they credible? And are they responsive? Do we have a plan that's just in writing and someone makes a complaint and nothing is actually done about it? That's not going to be especially helpful if they're if there is later an inspection occurs, but frankly, we don't want the inspection to occur. We want, if a complaint's made, we want it responded to so that that's the end of it, and the employee doesn't feel compelled to make a complaint. Look at the work order system. Are safety issues given priority? Are work orders timely processed? Is feedback provided? Again, it's just, you know, giving credence to the complaint and making sure that they're taken seriously. It's helpful to survey employee perception of safety commitment and program. I think that'll give you a read if your workforce thinks they're working in a safe environment and or if they feel like their complaints are taken seriously, they're less likely to make a complaint and invite OSHA to the work site. And investigate accidents and near misses. Take advantage of those opportunities to learn and figure out should this have been is this something that could have been prevented? Luckily, nothing happened here. Next time, something might. Was this just a random, nothing we could do about it, or could we try to make this safer? That's the best way to learn. You always say you learn the most from your mistakes, and I prefer to learn from other people's mistakes the best rather than making my own. And that's kind of falls along the same lines. A near miss is a great way to learn and not actually have the fallout from the actual incident. So the mechanics of an inspection, let's say we weren't able to avoid whatever the basis was, whether it was an employee complaint or a national emphasis program, just to kind of give you this general background. Generally, there's no advance notice required, and in some ways, actually, if it appears that there was notice given to kind of, you know, give opportunity to fix anything, that can lead to some pretty stiff penalties. However, you know, if it's following an accident, you probably know it's coming. So work with your attorney, work with your safety department, make sure that you get your ducks in a row because you're given the gift of getting the advance notice. The scope can be comprehensive or partial. If it is you know, one of the national emphasis programs or strategic targeted inspection, it could be pretty broad. If it's from an accident, it would likely be limited just to that accident site, but partial inspections can be expanded based on the information gathered. So say it's a construction site and there was an accident involving a forklift on one side of the project. As the inspector is walking across to get to that location, if she sees folks not tied off on the vertical structure, there you go. You just got your inspection expanded to also include tie-off procedures. So, you know, again, this is when we have the gift of getting advance notice, try to prepare. But also, and we'll talk about this in the top 10 list, but just to hit this as an example, this is why advanced training is helpful, so that if we don't have the notice, it's okay. Our folks have been prepared and they know what to do. Inspections can occur within regular working hours and at other reasonable times with reasonable limits and in a reasonable manner. So it needs to be reasonable. And I will say, you know, this is really kind of luck of the draw on who your OSHA inspector is. Some are really reasonable and will work with you. Some are less so, and there are some mechanisms in place that we'll talk about in a moment to help. But I do think it's important to whomever is going to be the point of contact to establish a good relationship with the inspector because, again, going back to our earlier slide, everyone's got the same common goal. We want to have a safe workplace. We just don't want to offer up anything that could be either taken out of context or, you know, unnecessarily harm us. And sometimes when you're overly antagonistic, it can cause more problems than it can help. Credentials, an officer is required to present credentials to the person in charge when they're entering the property. And you notice in the slide, it's only when entering the property. So they can video off-site. So again, picking on the construction industry, if there's a job site that's in plain view, OSHA inspector walks by, you know, on the other side of the fence, not in sight, that inspector could be recording, and there's no necessity to present the credentials or be be actively, you know, engaged in an actual inspection. So it's, again, a reminder to just make sure that employees and workers on the job site are trained, and we're enforcing the training to make sure that anything that's observed is going to be compliant with our safety protocols. If there is, you know, a formal inspection, it'll start with an opening conference, and in that instance, the inspector will explain the nature, the purpose, and the scope of the inspection, and also identify any records that are needed. And an inspection likely will not be limited to one day. It's not truly just the inspection. It's kind of the investigation. So that, you know, we will try to limit it as much as possible. We don't like to have OSHA out on multiple occasions. But if there was an accident, there's going to be, you know, be interviews of witnesses and persons involved. And, you know, depending on their schedule, they may not be there. So that's why if we get the advance notice or we're able to work with the inspector, it'd be good to have everybody there at once so that there's no need to continue to come back. The actual walk-around inspection, the employer and the employees may both designate a representative to accompany the officer. A lot of times this comes up, you know, if there's been an employee complaint, especially in the union sector, the union rep may be there to inspect as well, so that there's, you know, each side is represented during the walk around. And the officer may take photographs, gather records, interview employer and employees. They can employ reasonable investigative techniques. And it just as a quick side note, this is akin to a criminal type investigation. And I say akin, you know, it's sort of the same things you think about with criminal law, where, you know, there's evidence that can be obtained and you may need to suppress evidence. We'll talk about a warrant in a moment. So it's when you are thinking about the inspection, it's that's a good way to kind of think about what type of activity is actually occurring. And, you know, if none of these are followed, for instance, if the officer does not submit credentials, you could argue that anything obtained during that inspection should be suppressed and not used to support a citation. So that's kind of the framework that this is being used in. And then I provided a website, and when you get the materials, you could bookmark this depending on what your role is going to be in this. But that provides the record-keeping requirements, and I think it's just helpful to have a quick go-to. The OSHA website is pretty user-friendly. It provides information about the National Emphasis Program, any recent news, new rules coming out. So I think it's helpful to peruse, and it does give you some good information. And I cited the record-keeping because if you are going to be tasked with that in your organization, it will provide you the list of what you should be doing, so you make sure that you've got those protocols in place. Finally, in the inspection process, the last piece is a closing conference, and that's going to include the employer and the employee representative and the officer, and it's just sort of a way to close the loop on everything. The officer may or may not at that time indicate if they're issuing citations, but it at least gives everyone a chance to kind of talk about what's been reviewed, what's been seen, what's been learned. And then, you know, move from there. The rights of the employer during the inspection. So employer is entitled to have their representative accompany the officer during the inspection. You know, I recommend this is, you know, someone in safety, if you have a safety department. Certainly managerial level, it may depend on the nature of the inspection, who you have. But you certainly want someone that has been trained. You don't want this to be their first rodeo. You can have someone attend managerial interviews. That doesn't include the interviews with non-management employees. But one thing that we typically try to do, especially if there's been an accident and you can establish a rapport, employees are entitled to have an attorney present. I mean, that's something that if they request, they can have that person present. So depending on the nature of the inspection, and exactly what's going on, you can either ask to have the an attorney present. And it's not per se that the employer is precluded. It's just they can't force their way in if the employee doesn't want them because the employee may not be honest. The employer is entitled to a copy of all complaints. However, as I mentioned earlier, if a complaint is made anonymously, that will remain anonymous. So employer is not entitled to discover who made the complaint. The employer is entitled to have their trade secrets remain protected. So if perhaps this is involving a hazardous material that's being manufactured by your company, any information that's gathered, any record keeping, any inspection is entitled to be kept protected, and the officer in OSHA can be held responsible and liable if not. And I mentioned earlier that there is a warrant that portion here, and it's something that we always talk about at the beginning of any inspection. There's a U.S. Supreme Court case that essentially reined in the otherwise unfettered provisions of the OSHA Act, which just basically allow OSHA to inspect anything at all times. And the Supreme Court said, yeah, it's not that much. So here you see there are exceptions. I mean, if an employer consents, if it's an emergency situation and for plain and obvious hazards, a warrant's not required. But an employer can require and refuse inspection until there's been a warrant issued. And the warrant, you know, would limit the scope of the inspection. And so that's a benefit to it. However, ex parte warrants are acceptable, so you may not get a chance to challenge the scope. U.S. Magistrate judges can issue a warrant. And there's a strategic concern there, which, you know, I mentioned earlier. We don't want to be overly adversarial. I mean, obviously, we need to be protect and not invite the fox into the hen house, so to speak. But if we feel confident in our operations and we're just trying to limit the scope so that, you know, someone just isn't messing up on one particular day and the inspector happens to view that, then what we typically do is, you know, we'll mention this case that OSHA is very familiar with it, and just, you know, rather than require the official warrant, try to come to an agreement on the scope in advance. And that has typically worked well. Although, as I mentioned, you know, if you get a overly aggressive, unreasonable inspector, you may take advantage of and go this way. So you've had your inspection, and unfortunately it's determined that you violated the act, so you have been cited, and with that comes a penalty. The citation has to be issued with reasonable promptness, but no later than 6 months after the violation, although there are instances where it can be told. It needs to describe the nature of the alleged violation in detail. It needs to provide reference to the governing statute or regulatory provision that was violated. And it needs to establish a reasonable period of time to correct. And again, that's the term that's used here is abatement. Penalties recently were increased, and they have some teeth to them. Other than a serious, the penalty is up to $12,675. Serious is that much per violation. Repeat and willful can be $126,749 per violation, and a failure to abate is $12,635 a day. And there can be some criminal sanctions. A couple years ago, there were some big media news stories that came out of West Virginia area in the coal mining, that there were some executives that were being subject to criminal sanctions for OSHA violations for what was found to be extremely hazardous conditions. So the penalties certainly do have some teeth to them. After the citation, there's 15 days to contest, and you can have an informal contest at that point. The citation must be posted at the location of the alleged violation until the conditions abated, or for 3 working days, whichever is later. And you can negotiate a penalty reduction. That's where either your safety department or if you have a lawyer can assist. After the contest, depending on which plan you're under, if you're under federal or state, there are appeals mechanisms that ultimately leave outside of the agency. You work your way through the agency, and then you can move over to the court system. In preparing for an inspection, again, this is where I think HR can be really helpful. First impressions are important, so it's great to train the receptionist, security officer, whoever is the first point of contact that inspector is going to see. It helps to train them so that they know, what to do and that the inspector is getting a favorable impression. You want to plan for your opening conference, who will attend, where will it be held, preferably if you're in a warehouse, somewhere in the front of the office, so that, you do not want to allow the inspector to walk all the way through the warehouse to the back and be able to view any other hazards that might be beyond the scope of that inspection, and make sure that the participants that are involved are going to be trained. The people, are going to be speaking, the management level, they are speaking for the company, so again, train them, and then make sure that the records are organized. And this is probably going to be, based on for the majority of people on this call, a combined effort with safety and HR, depending on who's holding the training record or the record-keeping records, but also some training components that I think would fall under the HR purview. And also, ensure closure of audits. Sometimes insurance companies will offer free audits, and that can be dangerous sometimes because they'd be discoverable. There's no privilege attached to it. So while it's certainly good to take advantage of it, if you want to do an audit, it would be better to do that using counsel so that you've got the privilege protecting anything that comes out of it, the attorney-client privilege. Develop a reporting or employee complaint system. Again, back to the 20%, more than 20% of complaints or employee complaints, this can help get people, number one, to fix whatever hazardous issue may be, but also give people comfort and feel that they're being heard and listened to and they're less likely to complain. And enforce safety rules, and this might be a combined effort between safety and HR, but one of the strongest available defenses to a sanction or to a citation is the employee misconduct defense. And that works when we have a work rule in place. So anybody two stories or above in a vertical structure is required to be tied off. We provide adequate training. We train everyone who goes vertical. We have weekly safety meetings. So that's enforcement of the work rule, and we monitor for violations of the work rule. We have the safety meetings. We monitor if someone is seen untied off. They are reprimanded. That's very, very helpful. It's also very hard to correct if we're letting safety mishaps go by. It can be more of a challenge. So that is our... That's our background to put into place our top 10 list of things that HR professionals should be aware of in conjunction with how you can help your safety department or your organization, if you don't have a safety department, better prepare for when OSHA comes a knocking. So another poll question, and I may know the answer to this based on the first response, but does your company have a separate safety department or officer? With an answering no to this, just know that what I'm saying to you is you should be responsible for this, and or else talk to your organization about hiring a safety officer if it makes sense. If it doesn't make sense, if you're in a low hazard industry, again, it certainly doesn't mean that you're immune from OSHA, but maybe it doesn't make sense to have a separate officer. And in that case, this may be something that is helpful for you to have a grasp on, so that if someone does get hurt at the office, you know your reporting requirements, your record keeping obligations. Okay, So the 70% of folks do have a separate safety department or officer, but about 30% don't. So to that point, for you 30%, I would, you know, take what we're saying with the understanding that you should likely take some ownership of this, add it to your what I know is already very full plate. But depending on what type of industry you're in, how heavy you get involved in to, you know, the safety piece, I think it's really going to depend on the industry. For the 70% who does have a safety department, I think for this list, what would be helpful for you is think about how you can work with your safety department, how these two departments can work together to increase safety. But also, as you'll see, there's some, you know, while typically I would say OSHA kind of goes more, falls into the assisting the safety, there's some instances where the OSHA kind of bleeds into what I would consider more of an EEO type scenario as well. So you know, there can be some back and forth with that. So here's our top 10 list. Number one, avoid blanket post-accident drug test. And the background on this for you is that in 2016, OSHA published a final rule that it came under the reporting and retaliation sections of the Act. And it essentially took the position that certain workplace policies can deter or discourage proper workplace reporting. And included in that were post-accident drug testing policies. And so basically what they were saying is that a blanket policy that requires drug testing of an employee after a workplace accident is likely to discourage employees from reporting workplace injuries. So if an employee is drug tested after an accident and disciplined for violation of a drug testing policy, OSHA could determine that discipline was unlawful retaliation because the employer didn't have a reasonable basis to conduct that drug test. Your face might be looking like mine did when I first read this, particularly if you are in an industry that may have some conflicting rules, such as if you're in the motor carrier business, the federal motor carrier regulations require a post-accident drug test. So in that instance where there are no there's no cases on it, so I guess you're running a bit of a risk, but I would believe that the federal motor carrier regs are going to trump. So, you know, don't change your policy in that instance. If you have another statute that's governing you, the commentary is that rule is going to trump this rule. So, you know, don't make a change on that. Also, you know, following change of administration, because this was issued under the previous administration, the new Secretary of Labor, Acosta, has issued a notice that they intend to revise this, look back at it, but nothing has happened yet. So currently the final rule is still in effect. And so under the current interpretations, a blanket post-accident drug test could be considered retaliatory and could violate the final rule. So what do you do with this? I think, you know, again, if you have another statute on point, like the federal motor carrier regs, do not change your practice. That should be that's going to trump it. I think you're safe. While there's certainly an argument, and if someone brought a claim, they could argue that this rule is still in effect and there could be retaliation, but I think you're going to have a good defense that you are required to comply with the other rule. If you don't have a rule, you know, you're running some risk. If you continue it, you may need to have more probable cause after the accident. You know, if you can explain the reason why you chose to do it, I think that works. I think the issue was just blanket. Regardless of the circumstances of the accident, if we're going to drug test, that's more what the rule was getting at. So you may not have a blanket, but you may look at the circumstances. And the issue there, and I'm sure others of you are thinking this, is that, well, what happens, if in some instances I do, in some instances I don't, then I'm just setting myself up for discriminatory treatment. And I don't disagree with you. I think this rule really puts people in a pickle. And it's one of those where I think it's important for HR professionals to know, because it affects so many different things. And I think you may talk it over with your safety folks, talk it over with your lawyer, and decide what makes sense for you to do on that particular rule. It's just going to be case by case, and certainly not without some risk until the rule is addressed, if and when. Number two, top 10 list, prevent retaliation associated with safety complaints. So this is, again, this is in your purview. HR, I think, is really, you're an advocate for your employees, typically. And so while also making sure that the business runs smoothly, and this falls under your advocacy position. So if there's a safety complaint and it isn't done anonymously, or if it is, but someone finds out who it is, make sure that employee is not retaliated against, because there is a retaliatory provision of OSHA, and it's similar to the typical lawsuits that we see, and we just don't want to invite that type of claim. This one may seem a bit odd, but offer workplace stress management programs. Encourage regular breaks, offer job-specific opportunities to reduce stress and workplace injury, depending on your workplace. But if you have primarily office-based workforce, ergonomics consultation to come in and assist, you know, where there's the issue with carpal tunnel or based on your positioning. There have been complaints made about workplace injuries stemming from that, and if you are actively making strides to help your workforce with these known conditions, while they may not be fatal and cause severe injury, it still is something that could lead to an injury, lead to a complaint, and possibly a citation. And this is just an easy fix for the HR department to try to implement. What it also really goes to is, as I mentioned before, this, we're reducing our complaints by, making sure employees feel that they're valued, feel that we take them seriously, feel that we want them to be in a safe workplace environment. This is an easy, this is just an easy fix to kind of provide that resource to your employees, and it can improve productivity, and it can also reduce your likelihood for complaints. And I will say, our office actually implements some of this. We have a chair masseuse comes into the office about once a month, and support staff can go and get a massage, and it's a great benefit. They love it. It's to the extent that it helps with their sitting all day. If we ever had a complaint, I would think this is something that we could use to kind of show how we're helping to offset that. Number four, implement regular communications with employees about safety issues. So this is how you can work with the safety department. And going back to the slide about 20% of complaints come from employees, let's make sure they feel valued. Let's find out if they feel there's a hazard, if they think there's something unsafe, if they think there's a safer way to do it. Maybe it is safe, but it would meet, the bare minimum or even maybe a little above, but maybe there's a cost-effective way to make it even safer. They're on the front lines. They're the ones that'll probably know. So let's talk with them about safety issues. And I think that's a good HR component, because we are dealing with employees so often and providing a lot of training generally, that it makes sense for this to fall under HR's bucket. Positive employee relations to reduce complaints. So separate and apart from safety issues, of course, we're not going to let a bad employee get away with being a bad employee just to keep them from giving a complaint. But, if there's things that we can do to make their workplace a better environment, their employment, stress-free, if it's easy, cost-effective, why not? And it's just ways that we can reduce not only OSHA complaints, but any type of complaints. So this goes to my majority, my 70% folks. Coordinate with safety department. How can HR assist? Can we help you with compliance? Can we help you with record keeping? That just totally depends on your organization, depending how large it is, how the split's been in place. Can we be your backup for reporting? You know, as I mentioned earlier, I think that is, you know, checks and balances are great. So safety takes the, you know, if there's an accident, it's determined that safety makes the call. But, you know, you have 8 hours to report a fatality. At hour 7, someone in HR needs to reach out and say, hey, safety, did you do this? And if not, then HR can do it. If we can't get confirmation, then HR can report it. I think that's a great way that safety and HR can complement and work with each other. And depending on your organization and the workforce, there may be other ways. So then to my 30%, if you don't have a safety department, then it's important for you to help manage the safety protocol. So that would include the record keeping, hold safety meetings, post the safety rules, perform accident investigations. You know, much of what we talked about would then fall on your shoulders, and depending on the size of your organization, the type of industry that you're in, you know, it may or may not require very heavy involvement or take up a large chunk of your time, but it's something that you should at least be familiar with, at least have some training. You know, like I said, train those first line of defense, the receptionist, the security officer, the people that would most likely be taking somebody or accompanying the officer on the inspection. Those are things that need to be done in advance because you often don't get the notice. So let's make sure that they're ready for it when it happens. Review OSHA 300 logs if those are being maintained, and I hope that they are. Well, I hope there aren't a lot of incidents, but if there are, that there are logs. And look for areas of improvement and then create policy to increase the safety. This is helpful on so many different levels. Number one, to get back to the whole point of OSHA and that common ground that we all have, let's make sure that we're providing a safe workplace for our employees. And if there's ways that we can make it better that are, you know, cost effective and you know, if it's unsafe, it doesn't necessarily matter if it's cost effective or not. But if we're operating at a safe level, but it could cost effectively be even safer, let's do it. So look at those logs and come up with a plan that can help. And it's going to reduce, hopefully, the incidents. It's going to improve employee morale. It's going to give them a feel-good feeling that their employer cares about them, is trying to make their environment better. So that's again, a pretty easy thing for HR to jump in and do. Implement employee safety training and force rules. That's one of these tensions with the safety department if you have one. Figure out who should be handling the training, new rules. You probably, if you see an area that for improvement or maybe that might have been missed, and it might even be, you know, the HR is going to be familiar with maybe when changes in the organization occur. If there's, you know, new employees that are doing new type work, that may not have made its way to safety yet. So the HR department can say, ooh, I think we might need to do some new training, or this might be a new safety concern for us. Get with the safety, decide who's going to come up with the plans, make sure the training's implemented, there's new rules. You know, HR is aware when people are hired, so this is an easy way for them to be on the front line and catch anything. And then, you know, first line of defense during the inspection. The HR can, I think, maybe sometimes even better than safety, depending how your organization is structured, make sure those employees are trained for the inspection. Make sure that the workplace is kept tidy. You know, that's if they're walking through, plain and obvious, enforcing the rules that are in place can typically fall under HR's purview, and this can really help if there's an inspection and the officer's walking through. And they see, you know, everything's looking and ordered in place. HR truly is the first line of defense in that case, even if there is a safety department. And certainly, if there's not a safety department, it is you in that instance. So that is the presentation, and actually we are right at an hour. So I certainly don't want to keep anybody unnecessarily longer. I've got a few questions, and what I'm happy to do is there's three, so I'm happy to look at those. For those of you who would like to stay on, feel free. If you are ready to bounce off, go ahead. Thank you so much for joining us. If you have any questions, feel free to email me or call me. I'm happy to discuss and help you. But thank you very much for joining us today. And for the questions, one question I just saw that I can answer very quickly is someone's asked, can we email the information out? And yes, it will be sent. You will get a PDF of the PowerPoint that will come out in just a couple of days, and so we will definitely get that to you all. So don't worry about that. Okay. Let's see. There's a question. Let's see. Okay. Here's the first question. Have you seen or heard of any OSHA citations for blanket post-accident drug testing? Is OSHA actively enforcing this? So no. Yes. Right now, it is. I haven't seen any, and I don't think they're actively enforcing it. I really don't. I mean, it is out there. So I think where I see this to be more dangerous is that there's an accident, you drug test your employee as part of a blanket drug testing policy, employee fails, you terminate, employee's going to bring a suit for retaliation under the OSHA Act and under this rule. That's what I think is the bigger danger with this right now, not to say that OSHA couldn't enforce, because under the rule they can. I think it's unlikely that they're going to do that now. I think it's more likely you're going to have it's going to be used against you via lawsuit. Brought by a terminated employee who filed the drug test. There's a question, what is the latest on the electronic submission of records? If you want to bounce in and give a little more detail on that, I think just generally you can submit your records electronically. And if you go to the OSHA website, is pretty, again, like I said, it's user-friendly, it's pretty self-explanatory, and there is an area for electronically submitting your records. Do hospitalizations need to be work-related, or does that include all hospitalizations? The issue in mind is a heart attack. So heart attack has its own separate type of regulation, and if the heart attack occurs on site, there it is required to be reported. We actually had to look at this for a client a couple years ago, and yes, so that is one that should be reported. I know it seems kind of odd because it doesn't necessarily seem like it could be completely unwork related. If someone's got an underlying heart issue, that just happened to be where they were at that time. OSHA has, because of that, has a separate right on point that those should be reported, and then you can just, if it's determined that it wasn't related to any work related incident, then obviously there wouldn't be a citation. Can an employee request to have the employer present with them during the interview? Yes. So it really, kind of the employee can kind of guide that. Typically, this prohibition on employer participating in the interview is more for intimidation intimidation concern. The OSHA doesn't want the employer present intimidating the employee so that they're not honest for fear of losing their job. But if the employee wants them there, I find it hard to believe that the official would say no. I mean, I think it's in the most technical sense, they could get a warrant that required them to speak alone, but that would just be a really weird warrant. And I think you'd probably challenge that. From a practical standpoint, I don't really see anything affecting that. And somebody did just note, that's all the questions, but someone did note that OSHA just extended the electronic filing to 12/15/17. And so, you know, I think that, you know, it's been very it's been very easy, and you know, I'm hopeful that it will continue even beyond that. But you know, again, like I said, the OSHA website is very user-friendly and helpful. But if you do have any other questions, feel free to email or give me a call. So that's all our questions. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us, and I hope that you have a good rest of your day. Thank you.